chairman of the print, Shri Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar, DGCRPF, and Shri N. Ramchandran, Indian Police Foundation, to please take their seats on the dais.
The third session of the morning, and to start with, I request the DG BPRND to present the delegate with the plant. This session, we have got this session starts with the emerging police public perception of police and need for standardization in delivery of citizen-centric police services. And we have got three speakers, namely Sri Shekhar Gupta, Chairman The Print, Sri Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar, DG CRPF, and Sri N. Ramchandran, Indian Police Foundation. Mr. Shekhar Gupta would be joining soon. He is on his way. To introduce the speaker, first let me introduce Mr. Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar. Sri Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar, Director General CRPF, is an officer of the 1983 batch of the IPS of UP cadre. Mr. Bhatnagar is an MBA from the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, and has been awarded MPhil from Madras University in Defense and Strategic Studies, and is also alumni of the National Defense College. He has served in various capacities in Uttar Pradesh, including SSP of the state capital, Lucknow, and as DIGP in Agra, Kanpur, and Gorakhpur ranges. Also served as Special Secretary in the Home Department, Government of Uttar Pradesh. He has headed the Intelligence Department, Criminal Investigation Department, and Technical Services Department of the Uttar Pradesh Police. He has also headed the UP Police Promotion and Recruitment Board and the Prison and Reformative Service Department. He has served as police advisor to the government of Mauritius for a period of 4 years, 1995 to 1999. He has also served on deputation with ITBP as DIG and IG, having served in Northeast and also as IG headquarters. He was the first director of the National Police Mission, the post which I am continuing now. He is a keen sportsman and has won the All India Police Tennis Tournament. He has been awarded the Indian Police Medal for Meritorious Services and the President's Medal for Distinguished Services and Merit Award of the Mauritius Police. He served as ADG Headquarter from in different tenures. Blah, blah, blah. So, ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome Mr. Bhatnagar. The second speaker of the morning is Mr. N. Ramachandran, former DGP Assam and Meghalaya. A highly decorated and accomplished member of the Indian Police Service, he served the state of Assam and Meghalaya and has extensive experience in the field of policing, districts and state-level police administration, intelligence, counter-terrorism, and conflict resolution. At the central government level, he served the elite special protection group responsible for the security of Prime Minister. During the course of his two stints in the SPG spread over a period of 13 years, he contributed significantly towards building the nurturing the SPG to be world-class security organization that prides itself for its zero-error culture and commitment to continuous pursuit of professional excellence. Ramchandran served as the chairman and CEO of the port of Cochin for a period of from 2005 to 2011, during which period, apart from successfully implementing a slew of modernization initiative, developmental and infrastructural projects, he also served as chairman of the High-Level Committee on the Security Preparedness of India's Major Ports and Commercial Maritime Operations. Ramachandran has done extensive work on the national security implication of insurgency, terrorism, illegal integration, immigration, and transnational weapons and drug smuggling. Throughout his brilliant professional career in the Indian Police Service, he has demonstrated a passion and excellence. Ladies and gentlemen, again, kindly welcome Sri Ramachandran. Now I request Mr. Bhatnagar to open up his speech.
Good afternoon, everyone. DGBPRND, panelists, respected seniors, colleagues, and friends. Today, we are taking up the topic of public perception of police and the need for standardization in delivery of citizen services. In this, we have to first understand that how is the public perception of the police shaped? And what do we mean by citizen services? What is it that the citizen actually expects and wants of the police? From a force, we have to move to basically a citizen-centric service. That is the transition that we need to take. Everybody knows that the public view of the police is very important. It is so very important for the efficient functioning of the police, for them to be able to provide the services that are required, to provide the sense of security that is required. So public trust and support is extremely important, and we have to win it. It directly affects the legitimacy of the police. It is very important to connect with the people, and it is what will actually help us perform the job that we have been asked to do. If we can create a positive perception of the police, then it would really help us in being able to perform the duties that we are asked to do. We can have a citizen charter, which some of the police forces already have, which does enumerate some of these things with the time scale that it needs to be done. But that is something that we have to actually, that is just the nuts and the bolts. I think what is very important to understand at this point is that the police perception as well as the delivery of services is affected not just by the police or by the citizen, but there are a lot of players in this business. If you look at the whole environment, there are a lot of players who are there. It is the political executive, there are the interest groups, there are the other departments, the media plays a very, very important role. So does the judiciary, which educates and also delivers judgments on how the police has performed. We also have very many kinds of oversight mechanism that also look at how the police is performing. They also judge it, and their indictment of the police or otherwise also affects the public perception. If we were to look at what is the expectation today, we understand today that we are in an era of a new public management movement, which not only asks us to be more accountable, to give more quality services, but also to give value for money. So we need to improve our efficiency, our effectiveness, and also the quality of service that we provide, including the management costs that are involved. We also have to be outcome oriented. We also have to look at whether we are actually able to deliver the services that we are expected to. Now, if we look at the gap analysis as far as the police is concerned, we would find, and that has been brought out by many other speakers also, that we have little formalized strategic and perspective planning. we tend to live on a very short-term perspective, almost on a day-to-day basis, to see how we would carry the day. And that especially holds for the civil police. We have poor image and trust levels, though they have not been codified or quantified. I think we need to do that, for which I would put forth certain suggestions. Then there is a certain lack of autonomy which is there. The police reforms that have so long been on the anvil have not actually fructified. Many of the state governments are still very reluctant to carry out the reforms that are needed. We still have a colonial outlook, even though I may be repeating something which is well known, but I think it is something that we need to get over, and get over it fast. We are not citizen-centric. Our police is not the kind of dynamics that prevails. The citizen is not at the center of our focus. We are susceptible to external pressures, as you can see, politicalization. In a lot of cases, the conduct of the police, the way they allocate their resources, the way they do their deployment, the kind of actions that they take in law and order situations on crimes, actually gets affected by a lot of extraneous factors. And that is something that we need to guard against. Corruption also is an issue that we cannot ignore. It also corrupts delivery of services, and it really is a huge problem that we need to address effectively. Behavior again is an issue which is at the core of the public perception of the police. We need to work towards that. Now, some of the things that we need to address is, one is that our performance measurement is very ritualistic. We just look at certain figures and say we are doing well or we are not doing well. Or on the other hand, we will go for some anecdotal reports. We will cite one case or cite an instance that has happened where we have done well or badly. So there is really no system of seeing where do we stand as far as public perception is concerned and as far as the delivery of services are concerned. Personal management, like I said, that postings, transfers may not be the best man, may not be in the best place. Best performance, good performance may not get actually rewarded with a good posting or by a relevant posting. So those issues are there. Crime working is there. We are not sure of our crime rates. Whatever is published, whatever is recorded, maybe not the true picture at all. In terms of resources, of course, that crunch always remains. Then when we try and change things, we find that we are against a lot of factors. The managerial process re-engineering, there is a lot of resistance to change. Even the police informal organization steps in, even if you want to issue orders from the top. They don't get implemented because the police informal organization, that is also very powerful, is able to block the efforts of the senior management. Then in terms of inadequate sensitiveness to women, children, weaker sections, and to our citizens, that has always remained a problem. Now the point is that from the citizen perspective, what are reliable indicators of citizen safety? What is the connection between the perceived levels of safety and the actual crime levels? Have we done any work on that? Have we ever conducted any surveys? Have we gone directly to the citizen and asked him what the problems in the residential areas, which could be many, it could be just littering, it could be criminal damage, it could be drug addicts in public places. Do we do this kind of an effort in a systemic manner, in a systematic manner, so that we are able to allocate resources accordingly and do our deployments accordingly? We don't do crime victimization surveys. I think it is very important that we should also look at actually what are the issues about crime and victimization. Then only we would be in a position to actually be able to give the services that we want. Then we have to also look at the public perception, and the delivery of services will come not only from just what the actual position is, but what is the perception about the actual position. What is the fear of falling victim to crime, and the extent to which the public believes that the police is actually doing something for them. These are issues that we need to address. How does the public or the citizen evaluate any kind of service quality? The tangibles. The tangibles are important. It should be a good uniform. It should be a good vehicle. It should be a fair police station. All these things also convey a certain public perception and whether you are capable of delivering services or not. Reliability, responsiveness, assurance, and empathy. All these things are very important. Why I am pointing out to you all this is that we have to actually work on all these areas if we are able to project a good police image as well as to be able to deliver the services that the citizen wants. I would advocate, and this is something that is not being done, which is done in a lot of countries, is that we must have citizen surveys. We must go directly to the citizen and we must have representative national, statewide or district, citywide samples. This would really help us in being able to understand what the problem is. What is it that the citizen wants? And then the police has to be given the autonomy to be able to deploy its resources and to be able to deploy its personnel where actually the citizens want them. That is also a very, very important issue. And this would also give us the advantage of having a third party assessment of where we actually stand, whatever we do, whether it is bearing results or not. Because that debate always goes on, whether things are improving, not improving, whether what we are doing is enough, whether it is getting us where we want to or not. So I would suggest that we must go directly to the citizen, get their opinion, and also use it as a constant mechanism to see where we stand as far as our perception as well as service delivery stands. Then I think the other part of the story also we have not really looked at very seriously. That is the staff perspective. Do we ever go to our own people? Do we ever have any kind of a survey conducted as to what is it that they feel? It is very important that we must also be able to understand how they feel, because it is abundantly clear that if they have freedom of action and if they have a positive attitude, if they have a high level of commitment and job satisfaction, then only we would be able to get the results. So I would also advocate that we must have yearly surveys of the employees where we must ask them as to what their job satisfaction is, what is their level of responsibility that they feel, whether they feel that they have autonomy, whether what is their level of commitment. And these are something that we need to work on effectively and be able to gauge whether the efforts of the top management or the senior police officers are actually bearing fruit in increasing any of these parameters, without which I feel that whatever talk of good service delivery we may say or being citizen-centric is likely to fail. So I would suggest that this is also something that we need to take a serious look at. Now the constraints we are all aware of, I would not take much time in going into them. High centralization, bureaucratic determination of the change process and implementation of any reform, resistance to change, these are standard things which are there in any organization. Then again, the lack of connection between the performance on these parameters, I'm saying on actual public perception, on whether a person is perceived to be citizen-centric, whether the locality or the citizens there feel that this police officer is a good officer, he's committed to his job, he's honest, he's committed, he's polite, and he is responsive and empathetic to them, that is not rewarded in our system. Vested interests will always resist reform, autonomy, empowerment, and citizen-centric accountability. This we have been saying for the last, I would say the last 40 years. We have had umpteen commissions, umpteen reports, Supreme Court pronouncements, but nothing really changes much. Then I would again like to point out something that we need to address, and this is also something that needs a very, very concerted effort, is that how do we change the police culture? How do we change the culture of a police organization that is colonial by nature? And how do we segregate it from the larger segment of government service, which again, unfortunately, does not have a service culture? One could, of course, go even further to say that they all come from our society, and what kind of our society, are they law-abiding, are they compliant? That is a further issue, but I think it is very, very important that we must develop mechanisms that we should be able to develop a certain culture, a certain subculture within the police organizations and the police forces that is able to deliver what the citizen expects of us. Then ICT, of course, everybody knows about ICT. Everybody knows that it is standardizing police services, but at the same time, it can do so much and no more. Finally, the police job will, at some point of time, at some critical juncture, will be face to face. Unless we improve our face to face performance, the ICT can help us do our routine jobs very well. It can, you know, log things, it can see that the record is straight, it can see that it can be better supervised, there is a prompt response, there is a standard response, standard services are all through ICT, there is a certain time period. So a lot of all this attempt is being made to reduce the physical interface. And that is a good thing, because it is taking out from the purview of human intervention a lot of activities that can be otherwise carried out very satisfactorily and very fast. But again, I would like to emphasize that for any police person to be actually effective, he has to interact with the person who is in distress, who is either a victim or is in distress. No ICT is going to help you in that. It may help you in managing things, enabled to supervise, enabled to get their reactions, get their feedback. All that is possible. But I think we have to first and foremost address our core issues before our perception increases and before we are able to deliver what the citizen actually wants. This again is about the ICT. And this again, we can also, the other aspect that also I would like to project, and that has been taken up on many levels, is how do we project the good work that is being done. It is not that the police does not do good work. There are thousands of instances every day where police is doing outstanding work, but we are not able to communicate it, and we are not able to put it across. Of course, now with the social media and other opportunities which are there, we are able to project a lot of things, and we are getting also a good response from the public. So this has to be used. Our communication channels with the public has to be open, and we have to also use the media to be able to at least project the good work that is being done. And even the electronic media or even the movies and so on, there an effort can be made to see that reality is actually projected. To conclude, I would like to say that we have to go directly to the citizen. We have to see what he actually wants and be able to assess it in a clinical manner, in an objective manner, and in a good numerical manner to be actually able to see whether we are improving or we are where we were. We need to also go to our own people to see what is that they feel, what is their level of confidence, what is their level of autonomy, what is the level of their job satisfaction without, because unless we have a healthy police force with a good emotional quotient, we would not be able to perform as the empowered public of today expects. We have to be, of course, comprehensive, and we have to also have management systems in place which are able to objectively see whether we have achieved the outcomes or not. We should try and get over this, our methodology of assessing things, which is very outdated, and it is very anecdotal in most cases, as you would see. In the end, I would like to say that public perception is something that cannot be doctored. Public perception would always be, by and large, a true reflection of what you are. Unless you really pull up your socks and come up to their expectations, I have always believed that the public knows all. We may fool ourselves, we may feel that it is not correct, but the public is very wise, it is all-knowing, and it is also able to understand what the system is delivering, because it is at the facing end of most of our service deliveries. The police does a lot of good work, and if you look at the overall performances, we should use whatever good work is being done for projecting a better police image. And we should also back it up, because there is a lot of disbelief to what we say. That is why I say that we must back it up with surveys, by going to the citizens directly, by using third-party assessments to be actually able to measure what we are doing, to show that we are sincere in what we are doing, to show that we are responsive in what we are doing, and we are actually allotting resources and we are deploying manpower to look at what the citizen wants and not what certain vested groups or powers to be want. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. May I now invite Mr. Ramachandran to speak on the dais.
All my heartiest compliments to Mr. A.P. Maheshwari and the BPRND team for setting up this Vision Summit. It was about, I think, exactly 2 years back that we had our Police Foundation inaugurated from this very auditorium by the Honorable Home Minister. And so I'll take 1 minute about what it is all about. In fact, after a stint in the central government, fairly longish stint in the central government, I went back to my state and decided to take a tour of the police training college in Dergaon, a very beautiful campus, very sprawling campus. So I thought, let me go and spend some time in the police training institution. And to my shock, I found that it was the same training institution I went as a probationer after the NPA training, and nothing had changed. Over 30 years or so, nothing had changed. I went to some barracks and I found that the usual water is leaking from the roofs. And then I asked for the curriculum of the sub-inspector's training. And the principal produced a one-page typewritten sheet. I'm talking about just a few years back. A one-page typewritten sheet, which must have been typed several, at least two decades back. So while many states have done excellent work in improving police training, I find that a number of states in our country are still living in the 19th and early 20th centuries. And I felt extremely guilty that day, that I have been myself having a good time in Delhi and other places, being away from my cadre, and I am also responsible for what is the state of affairs. So that's why this thought about starting some kind of a think tank in the policing space started. And I started consulting our colleagues, a number of serving and retired seniors, and they were all supportive of this idea, and that's how we started this Indian Police Foundation. Basically, we thought that there needs to be an intellectual space where police officers do meet and reflect on what is